The love of God, the grace of Christ, and the community of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We join together in the call to worship. Emmanuel, God, you are with us.
We have heard the promise of the prophets.
We have caught the notes of an angel's song.
We have seen the star of the heavens.
This day we have come to be with you.
Because you have come to be with us.
We seek an innocent, helpless baby in a crude manger. And you, O God, who are the strongest and weakest,
the mightiest and humblest, have found us.
Now we may love each other as you desire, crying aloud, Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, and goodwill among all people.
Seated. Let us continue in prayer. O holy God, we hear the story of shepherds and magi, of maiden and carpenter, of prophets and angels, and we too come to Bethlehem for a blessing. You are born in our hearts because you have chosen the weakness of our bodies for your birth. We are filled with love because you have taken upon yourself our humanity. We are filled with hope because you have offered us your spirit, your life, and your light. We are filled with wonder because all that is meek and lowly and humble in us and in creation becomes holy this night. Our salvation has come into this holy time, and we are filled with gratitude. Amen. I invite up the McLean family to light the Christ candle.
The angels sing the glory of God in the highest heavens.
Be not afraid, for I bring you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors.
At Christmas, God speaks in signs. The baby in the manger is a sign of a new life and a new governance shining in the world. Christ is born, and the world is filled with the promise of hope, signs of peace, joy, and the incarnation of God's love.
Holy are you, source of all new life among us.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
We join with all creation in joyful praise.
We light this candle because God has been made flesh and dwells among us.
Let us join together in singing Joy to the World. Christmas. If any young or young at heart want to come forward, they're welcome to, but you're also just welcome to stay in your seats tonight. On Christmas Eve, we make our final preparations to welcome the Christ child into our lives. We have been spending weeks preparing, learning how to live in hope and peace and joy and love, All throughout the weeks of Advent, we lit the Christ candle, and the light got passed on. Sorry, we lit the Advent candles, and the light got passed on and passed on, and just now the McLeans lit that Christ candle, the light of the world. And all throughout the city, throughout our neighborhoods, there are little indications of that light being passed on in little ways. We see at Christmas, and it brings joy, the lights that people put up outside their houses, the lights on Christmas trees and stores, and some people in churches have lights lining up the path on the way in to the entrance to indicate the way. Light becomes something very strong, a beautiful symbol for us. And years and years ago, there were many prophets who talked about the Messiah coming. There were times that were very difficult, particularly for the Jewish people. They were being ruled by unfair and unjust governments. They were dealing with war and strife and famine and various other things. And there were prophets that spoke promises about a Messiah that would come and would change the world for them and into the future, that would come and save them. And the prophet Isaiah, which we will hear in a little bit, talked about how there would be a great light that would come in the darkness and change everything for them. It's hard to imagine how significant that light in the darkness, that symbol, was for them, because we have electricity, we have light everywhere around us. It's very rare that something is truly dark unless you're way outside of a city in the middle of the country. There's lights even at night all around us here. But back then, there was no electricity, there were no street lights, and things were truly dark at night. They could not see anything at all. So the significance of what this one light that would come and change everything for them was huge. And when I hear that scripture, it makes me think about how much light can make a difference in my own world, in our own home. One of my favorite things to do, and I will probably do it later tonight, is to go home on Christmas Eve when it's late at night and to turn out all the lights in the house except for the light of the Christmas tree in our living room, and to just sit there quietly after the kids have gone to bed, and to just sit there in silence and awe and wonder, and I just get filled with so much peace and joy by that light. So when later on, as we share the light of Christ during Silent Night that comes from our Christ candle, and when the lights get dimmed down, I want you to remember just about how strong the power of that light is when it gets spread out throughout the darkness. I know we have not been able to do that for many years now, but I know people are looking forward to resurrecting that tradition and to be reminded that Jesus came as the light of the world, and how that one light spread and changed the world. And it reminds us of how the power of just one child that came into the world in a fragile little body of a baby changed the way that everyone can live, and reminds us today, even in the midst of dark situations and war, that if we look to Christ's life, that it can change life today on earth as well. So we are going to continue and hear about many other prophets talking about the coming of Christ.
A reading from Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onwards and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
A reading from Luke. In those days, the decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was emperor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
To see, pa-ra-pa-pa-pa. finest gifts we bring. Pa ra pa pam pa, ra pa pam pa, ra pa pam pa.
Reading from Luke. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, who's the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that's taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them.
Oh,
Please be seated. A reading from Matthew. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise seekers from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? For we observed him, his star at its rising, and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him, and calling together all of the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise ones and learned from them the exact time where the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage.' When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Reading from Matthew. Having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another road. Now, after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he'd been tricked by the Magi, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years or under, according to the time that he had learned from the Magi. This is the witness of the early church. Thanks be to God. When I was a kid, our family had a nativity set, and it really wasn't a very attractive set. Sorry, Mom. It was made out of rough wood, and Joseph's head at some point in time had been broken off and had been glued back on, but was a little bit crooked. And the angel's wing was bent in an awkward way, hanging there from the star. It wasn't very pretty. So one year, I remember, I decided I needed to make it a bit more attractive. So do you remember tinsel? I don't see tinsel so much anymore. There were the long, thin, metallic silver threads you'd hang on the tree. I would take tinsel and I would decorate the nativity with tinsel because I thought it had to look beautiful. It should be beautiful. Christmas is a time for beauty, isn't it? There's something wonderful about a tinsel-touched nativity. There's something magical about angel-filled skies and shepherds running to find a picture-perfect scene of animals and parents peacefully surrounding a clean, smiling newborn. There's something uplifting and cheery about Christmas greetings and singing Silent Night by candlelight. It's as if during Christmas we want the world to just stop spinning for a while so we can hold on to this idea of something perfect, that perfect world, those perfect feelings of love and goodwill. The little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. Really? Now, there are some very good reasons why this Christmas card sentimentality is so pervasive, why this desire exists in us to decorate the nativity with tinsel. And one of those reasons is Luke. If someone asked you to tell the Christmas story, chances are you would recount the biblical story as it appears in the gospel according to Luke. Most of it, anyway. It's Luke who describes the Annunciation to Mary and Mary's song of praise. It's Luke who speaks of swaddling clothes and a child lying in a manger. It's Luke who includes the angelic announcement to the shepherds and the great company of the heavenly host. It's Luke who has Mary holding these things and treasuring them in her heart. Luke's story of the coming of Christ is wonderful. It's beautiful. It's poetic. It's magical. It inspires us to see the story of Emmanuel through tinsel-touched glasses. And then there's Matthew's version of the story. Do you know Mr. Bean, this British television comedy? One of my favorite episodes of Mr. Bean is the Christmas episode. Well, in one scene, Mr. Bean is walking down the street and he sees through the window a nativity set. And he goes in the shop and he decides to have a little bit of fun with this nativity window display. And the television camera zooms in on the nativity itself. Everything looks lovely and perfect. But suddenly from the right-hand side of the screen rumbles a toy army tank. And it points its gun at everyone and it scares the dickens out of the shepherds and Mary and Joseph and they all run fleeing. It's quite a funny scene because a tank seems so out of place in the nativity. I wonder if Mr. Bean had been reading the gospel according to Matthew. Because Mr. Bean's fun with a toy tank hits the nail on the head when it comes to Matthew's version of the Christmas story. because Matthew inserts a bit of harsh realism into this tinsel-touched nativity. You see, in Matthew, the story of the birth of Christ is told very differently than Luke's version, and it's a version we don't hear as much because it's not nearly as pleasant to listen to. In Matthew, there are no mangers, there's no cattle stalls, no shepherds, no heavenly host, no tinsel. You see, in Matthew, there is a king named Herod, and just like an army tank, Herod rumbles onto the scene one verse after the baby Jesus is born. In Matthew, as you heard a few minutes ago, Herod finds out about the birth of this new king and vows to get rid of him, so he plots to procure information from the Magi, but when that fails, he takes more desperate measures, sends soldiers to Bethlehem to kill all the male children under 2 years of age. Mary and Joseph manage to escape. Matthew's story is filled with tension and fear and death. Matthew doesn't seem as concerned about providing material for sentimental Christmas television specials because Matthew's version would probably be rated R for violence. Instead of a tinsel-touched nativity, there are instead wailing mothers and crying children and slaughtered babies and a holy family fleeing for their lives. You can see why we usually stick with Luke's version. But instead of pretending Matthew's version is not there, or instead of ignoring it, why don't we spend a few minutes with it tonight? As ugly a story as it is, one of the questions for us to ponder on at Christmas time is, what does this story, Matthew's version of this story, tell us about God? That God would take on flesh and become one of us and make the grand appearance, not in a utopian paradise, but rather in the midst, right in the midst of the very worst of the human condition, right in the middle of a war zone. What does that say about God? We use a word to describe this mystery of God coming among us in human form, and that word is incarnation. We've sung it. We've heard it a few times tonight already. The mystery of God wanting so badly to show us the way of love that God would take the radical step of coming to us personally. This is what we celebrate at Christmas, Emmanuel, a word which means God with us, God becoming one of us in the one we know as Jesus Christ, coming to show us where we can find abundant life, coming to show us where we can find healing and peace, coming to show us that we do not suffer alone in this world, but that God is with us right here, right now. And Matthew's version of the birth of Jesus tells us that God was willing to enter into the absolute worst of human experience to prove it. As an innocent baby pursued by soldiers and a demented king, as a hungry refugee fleeing across the desert, as a vulnerable child surrounded by grief and fear. If God was willing to enter that kind of world, if God was willing to jump into that fray, what does that say about this God we worship? God cannot be accused of being out of touch with the human condition. That's the miracle of incarnation, isn't it? God entering the real world of pain and death and grief, not the world where everything is in tinsel, but the world rather of you and me, the world where we live and work and struggle and experience pain and experience conflict, the world we read about in the newspapers, that's the world God enters. And I believe that the world God enters into is the world of violence between Israel and Palestine at this time. God chooses to be born into that place of violence, I believe, so that God can begin to show us the way to peace. We may wish to linger in the joy of Christmas sentimentality, but the why of incarnation forces us to take a hard look at reality. And we see the why of incarnation in the life and ministry of the person that that baby grew to become. And that baby grew to become the one who recognized the humanity of those who had no power and invited them into a new kind of life. The one who recognized the humanity of those who had power and invited them into a new kind of life. The one who never demeaned or defamed or dehumanized in his work for justice and peace. The one who had compassion on those who were victims of abuse. The one who had compassion on those who perpetrated abuse. For usually there is deep trauma at work in both sides. Remember the story of Jesus being crucified? What did he say? He said, "God, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." That's compassion. That's understanding. He was the one who, when tested at every turn by those who were wanting to entrap him by forcing him to choose sides on an issue, a philosophical question or a political question or a theological question, Jesus continually refused that worldview of binary and instead chose relationship. Yes, Jesus opposed oppressive structures, but he was profoundly non-violent and did not dehumanize anyone in the process. He saw the humanity of all people, and he did not choose sides which were binary. He chose the center, the third way. He chose humanity. He chose peace. And yet, binary thinking, taking an unwavering position on one side or another in a conflict, seems to be what we do these days. But such a view risks narrowing our thinking, shrinking our scope of vision, preventing us from seeing the humanity and the pain of the ones we see as the other. And we scroll on social media and we see posts like "Free Palestine" or "Stand with Israel," messages which are binary. And I wonder if such messages actually are blockades to honest exchange, if these memes and videos actually feed on fear and grow our fear and actually send us further apart from one another. Emmanuel, God born among us, brings with it the message that we are all created in the image of God, all of us. Maybe Jesus was born in a war zone because that's the very place where such a message needs most to be heard. Two men, one Palestinian and one Israeli, sat with a friend of mine together and shared a coffee. I spoke about these two a few weeks ago at Knox, Waterloo. I have a picture of those two tonight. Each of these men has lost a daughter to the violence in the Middle East. One to a Palestinian suicide bomber and the other to an Israeli soldier. The man on the right, he sat with my friend and said these words, "My name is Rami Elhanan. I am a Jew. I am an Israeli. But before anything else, I am a human being. And this Palestinian is my dear brother. In many ways, he is one of the closest people to me on earth. What makes us so close is the price we have both paid as an outcome of this ongoing conflict between our two nations." The other, on the left, spoke, and he said, "My name is Bassam Aramim. I am Palestinian. I spent 7 years in an Israeli jail for a mistake I made when I was 12. I am proud to call this my ex-enemy, this man, my brother. Because we are fighting together, we are struggling together for peace. These two one-time enemies are part of a movement called Parent Circle Family Forum. I encourage you to Google it. It's profound. It's life-changing to read their stories. What they do is they help build peace between two cultures. It's an organization made up of people who have lost loved ones in the conflict, but who now seek peace at all costs. They have made a conscious decision not to get caught in the binary, not to get caught in the sides, but to see each other as human and to seek peace and reconciliation. They are determined to be agents of reconciliation. And I think what these two people offer is a way beyond the binary. They offer a third way, a different way. Together, they said these words, "Don't be pro-Palestinian. Do not be pro-Israeli. Do not choose a side. Choose peace. Choose peace." Emmanuel, God born among us, brings with it the message that we are all created in the image of God. Maybe Jesus was born in a war zone because that's the very place where such a message most needs to be heard. There are no sides. There's only humanity in all its brokenness and operating out of a place of trauma and pain. In this case, I believe this conflict is rooted in generational trauma. The Palestinians who have been denied statehood and basic human rights since the 1940s, and the Jews who have endured millennia of horrific persecution. Both sides are entrenched in trauma and entrenched in a view of this conflict which prevents them from objectivity. That's what we do in stress. We move to binary. So the question for us here in Kitchener-Waterloo is, what can we do to help? By taking a side? Is that helpful? We long for peace. We long for ceasefire. We call for ceasefire. We long for the bombs to stop. We long for healing. This is why God came in Jesus Christ, to try to bring peace and healing, to show us a third way. When we're being pulled to choose a side in a binary worldview, maybe Rami and Bassam show us this third way. Do not choose a side. Instead, choose peace. Preach peace. Speak peace. Live peace. Embody peace. God born among us, an incarnate prayer for peace. Matthew, in his version of the birth story, rattles us out of Christmas sentimentality, doesn't he? Helps us to remember that at Christmas time, God entered a nasty world because that's the world that God wants to save. We may encounter Herods at every turn in life, but that's when we can remember Emmanuel, the Prince of Peace. Some of you may be sitting there feeling a little uneasy, thinking, that's not what I expected to hear on Christmas Eve. Blame Matthew. I am grateful to Matthew for helping us to remember the why of incarnation. Why did Jesus come among us? And he came to show us reconciliation, and he came to show us the way to peace. All people, peace. No sides, peace. I've seen a lot of signs this year that say, keep Jesus in Christmas. You've probably seen them too. I wonder if we should make one that says, keep Herod in Christmas. Do you think that would fly? Maybe not. I think it would certainly keep things real. Friends, the Christmas story is fantastic, but it's not fantasy. It's fantastic because of the good news of incarnation. We turn it into fantasy when we make it all cozy and nice and avoid the uncomfortable bits, the real bits. Cozy and nice is fine for a while, It refreshes us and it relaxes us. But the good news is that God is in the midst of both the light and the darkness, giving us strength and giving us hope for the long haul of life. Amen.
The time for celebrating Christ's birth is here. Family, food, hope, peace, joy, and love. Giving abounds. So let us be generous here and now. Let us worship the Christ child with our offerings. Bring all that you are and all that you have. Let us each give of our time and our talents and financial gifts as we share the good news of Christ's birth.
Continue our prayer together. Jesus Christ, you are the life of the season we call Christmas. You are child and ruler. All our stars point to your birth. All our wanderings come home to you. All our griefs and delights find a place in the stable where you choose to transform poverty and pain and loneliness and rejection. Your light shines in our lives. Your peace embraces our anger, sorrow, and loss. Your life opens us to new discovery of ourselves and our neighbors, however we may find them, as poor as shepherds, as exotic as magi, as excited as angels, as helpless as infants. In your humble birth, we discover your everlasting mercy and grace. Gracious God, we pray tonight for all who have come with us to Bethlehem. We pray that those who are poor and cold and hungry, like the shepherds, might hear good news. We pray that those who are wandering and searching, like the Magi, might find a place to leave their gifts and burdens. We pray that those who are busy, hurried, and preoccupied, perhaps like the innkeeper, might know the peace that comes from a genuine act of hospitality. And we pray for those like Herod who have power, that they may use that power for the good of all people. We pray also for ourselves, we who need comfort and peace and joy in this starlit season and all the days of our lives. Shine your light on us, we pray, and on those we name now in the silence of our hearts. May we who bear the image of Christ live as your faithful children. May the good news of Christ guide us. May it live in our hearts. May it be on our lips. And may it guide our hands. These prayers, spoken and unspoken, the prayers which will come to our hearts and minds even after we go our separate ways tonight, the prayers which lie so deep that they cannot be put into words, we offer them all in the spirit of Christ, who was born and died and was raised. And together God's people say, Amen.
As we sing Silent Night, we will be sharing the light of Christ throughout the congregation. We haven't done this in a while, so we're going to just remind you about the safe way to do it. If you didn't get a candle on your way in, maybe just raise your hand or step out in the aisle and an usher will bring you one. I'm going to light this candle from the Christ candle.
And we're going to demonstrate how you will light it with one another.
So the candle that is lit stays in place and doesn't tip over. So the candle that is not lit gets tilted towards that candle and then stays upward. And you stay in your place, keep it away from your hair and in front of you. And we will share the light of Christ. And then when Silent Night is over, we invite you to take a moment to pause, blow out your candles, and there will be bins at the exits for you to put them in. And if you don't want one of these, there are also some candles that are battery powered if you'd prefer not having a flame. Let us share Christ's light and sing Silent Night.
May the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you along the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open your hearts to love. May you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen.
Amen.